Hey, how's it going, guys? And welcome back to the Monster Taming and Chill podcast, where we interview various members of the monster taming community to gain a greater insight to their works. So today I'm very happy to have with me Claudia, the developer of Ova Magica, a monster taming and farming game inspired by games such as Pokemon, Animal Crossing, Stardew Valley, and more. So how's it going, Claudia?
Hi, Ed. Well, I'm pretty nervous. You know why?
Well, that's good. Nervous is sometimes good. So today we got a ton of questions to get through from both me and the community. So we're going to jump right into it. But before we do, I figured that as a time that you guys are watching this, we're recording this a couple days in advance, the Ova Magica Kickstarter will be live. So if you want to check out the Kickstarter or their Steam page or their Twitter or whatever, I'll have all their social media linked in the description of this video. So just expand it and you can check it out right away. But anyways, let's get into the basic question. So just tell us about yourself.
So hi all, I'm Claudia, and I'm a game dev from Germany. I'm from Bavaria, so I like typical Bavarian things, like going to the beer garden, drinking beer, and eating pretzels. Well, that's not so relevant for the game, but I thought it's maybe interesting for some.
Oh, yeah.
And if you visit Bavaria, please visit a beer garden.
Yeah, I've actually never heard of a beer garden.
What, Ed? You never heard of a beer
garden?
Never
heard of it. Never heard of it in Canada.
Oh, my God. I tell you something. In the game Ova Magica, there is a beer garden inspired by my hometown.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah, so you need to play it and visit it.
Yeah, exactly. So what inspired you to become a game developer?
So what inspired me was, you know the game Stardew Valley?
Yeah.
Probably. And the dev, Eric Barone, he inspired me because he finished his education and couldn't find a job. And he was like very brave and worked on Stardew Valley alone.
Yeah.
And his success story kind of inspired me to follow your dreams and, yeah, not to be discouraged. So it was him actually who inspired me to try myself. Maybe I can do it too.
That's awesome. I mean, I've seen and played some of Ova Magica, and I mean, the game's really polished. So you're definitely doing a good job.
Oh, thank you. That's so nice.
No problem. So, okay. So, why don't you tell us what is Ova Magica for those who don't know, and what does the game entail?
So Ova Magica is a mix between the farming life sim genre and the monster taming genre. So it combines both genres together, and that's like the basic idea of the game. So if you like games like Pokemon, Monster Ranger, and farming sims like Stardew Valley or Harvest Moon, I think it will be the perfect game for you.
Okay, yeah, that's a great way to summarize it. Yeah, no, it's actually that was pretty much what I was thinking like would be the best way to summarize it. So you got that pretty well.
I read your mind. I can read it.
The next question I have here is, like you said, Ova Magica mixes monster battling with farming and even dating. So what inspired you to mesh all these types of games together?
Okay, so I will tell you that's maybe not so a glamorous story, but I tell you the truth. It was like I started for hobby. I didn't start like a professional with game dev.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to make a game which has all the things I like to play myself. So I loved Pokemon as a child, and I thought, oh, I want to have these things in my game. And I also loved Harvest Moon. And as an adult, I loved Stardew Valley. So I just started implementing all the things inside of it. And I noticed, oh, it kind of works really well. And it evolves. And so it wasn't like a master plan behind it. I just wanted to add elements I would love to play myself. Yeah.
You know, I find that some of the best games are made like that. Like, it's not a business decision or anything like that. It's just like because we see a lot of games in the monster taming genre. There's like bullet hell games. Obviously, you have the RPGs that are typical. You have some games that are like action combat and stuff like that. And it's all different developers saying, you know, this is how I would like to play the game. And those games tend to be the ones that are really interesting.
Yeah, so the devs have actually fun making them
Yeah,
and are
exactly.
not forced to.
Exactly. It's always so great to see there's so many different like perspectives on how people would like their monster taming game to be, whether it be like more action oriented, ranching, farming, etc. So
Yes.
this goes. Oh, sorry. You go ahead. Go ahead.
Yes, and I'm also very hyped about so many monster taming games we have currently. So it's like really exploded the last years,
Yeah.
and I love the genre, so I have so much to play. So I'm
Yeah.
really excited about all the different takes people make on the genre.
I'm scared my Discord server is gonna run out of channels because I think there's a limit.
Oh my God. Yeah, I saw you have already a lot of
Yeah, it's
games.
multiplying fast.
Well, but actually it's great. Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's definitely great. So the monsters you can tame in Ovamagicka are these little they're so adorable. There's these little blob creatures. Was there something specific that inspired them? And if so, sort of give us a explanation on that.
So when you played some RPGs, so some of you probably played, there's always like a slime monster.
Yes.
It's mainly like the first enemy or something like that. And I am honest, I actually wanted to do like many different monsters, like in Pokemon. And I started with the slime. It was called Blob. I called it Blob. And I noticed, okay, I am still alone back then. It was still a hobby. And I noticed, how can I do like 150 monsters alone? I will never be able to finish this thing. So I thought, okay, this looks so cute, the slime. So I started to somehow experiment and change it to add like little details, like rings or bunny ears, rabbit ears. And I noticed, okay, it's really cute, and it's like a simple, cute idea. I just stick with it.
Yeah.
So that's the truth that I needed to find a solution which works and a small team can do.
Yeah.
And I'm actually really happy how it turned out because it's like the, what do you say, Markenzeichen is in Germany. Like you notice right away when you see a blob, it's Ovamagicka. So you
Yes,
know, oh,
yes.
that's a yes.
It's like a trademark.
Yeah,
Yes, yeah.
trademark.
Yeah,
Sorry,
and
my English.
no, it's okay. It's okay. That's actually a really good point. I can't remember who I was talking to this about, but we were talking about like how sometimes limitations actually create really good ideas. So
Wow.
oh, it was I think it was the Final Stardust developer. His antagonist is a twin because it was easy for him to have sort of like the palette swaps, but that ended up turning into a really cool like story idea for him. So sometimes trying to manage a game on a smaller scale actually ends up making it really cool because you're right. You see a blob, you know it's Ovamagicka, right? So
Yes.
it ends up working out pretty well.
Yeah, and I am honest, some people complained that you have like only one kind of monster. And I know that when you see games like Pokemon, you have like, oh my God, like thousands different ones. But you just have to think that behind Ovamagicka, a small team
Yeah.
is not like a huge studio like Nintendo.
Yeah.
So we try the best with the resources we have.
Yeah. And definitely like I said before, there are a lot of monster taming games which I love, but a lot of them they you couldn't if you were to look at the monster, some of them have really cool designs, but if you were to look at the monster, you wouldn't know which game it's from. So, it's good to have that uniqueness behind your monsters anyway.
I'm happy you say that. Do you have a favorite blob already?
I'm thinking the poo blob's
Oh my God.
pretty good.
Why everyone loves this poop blob? I created a monster, you see.
Yeah. So,
Oh my God.
do you guys have a specific number of how many blobs there's gonna be?
So we plan like doing around 75 to
Okay.
100 different base blobs. But you can crossbreed all together, so you
Yes.
can actually combine like thousands.
Oh, okay. I vaguely remember the that there was a crossbreeding feature. So that's definitely really cool. How many types are there going to be in the game? Like, you know, like fire, water, grass.
There are three main types. So there are like magma. What's it in English?
Yeah, magma. Yeah, you're right.
Magma. Yeah. storm and forest.
Okay.
And they're combined like subtypes. For example, magma is like fire, explosion, evil, demons, dragons, devils. Storm type are blobs with wind, ice, water, like a turtle blob, a fish blob, or a bird blob. And forest are like bug blobs and plant blobs.
Okay.
So, yeah, so it's there's kind of a variety.
Yeah, that's cool. That's cool. So... tell us a little bit about the gameplay loop. Like, what's your goal in Nova Magica?
So the game is designed that the player has a lot of freedoms, but the base gameplay loop works like this. So I'm not so good in explaining, I try.
That's okay.
So you have like an in-game clock. It's a day. Like you have from 8 a.m. to 12 p.m.
Yeah,
and the in-game clock runs, and you can decide what you want to do on the game in that day.
Yeah,
so you can decide if you go battling, if you do some farming, or if you want to meet the people in Clovertown, or go on expedition and find like treasures or new blob eggs. And so the base loop is to fill your days with activities and progress in the game.
Okay,
and there is a story behind. Of it, so the people of Clovertown have their problems, and you get to know them better, maybe fall in love and help them. You can will win some tournaments, battle, and do a lot of things with your blobs, and the story will evolve like slowly when you do all these activities, and you will unlock new things. But okay. It's not so linear, so you can decide yourself if you do first this or that. Yes.
Yeah, it's good. It's something, a little bit of something for everyone. If you like battling, you can go battle. If you like farming, you can farm. If you want to interact, you can interact. It's like something for everyone.
Yes, I hope that.
So the world map, I've actually had some personal DMs asking about it. Will there be, how does the game's map sort of function? Will there be like different, you mentioned expeditions, so will there be like different areas to explore, or will the game sort of be more focused on like a center town area?
So the main focus is like typical for farming sims around a town.
Yeah.
So in Nova Magica, it's Clovertown.
Yeah.
And you can explore the areas around it, like Clover Valley or your farm.
Hmm.
And this area is mid-sized. It isn't like a huge open world.
Yeah.
But what's special about the game is that you can enter the blob worlds. So you summon gates.
Oh.
You need a special item to summon them. And there are a lot of secrets. You can like use every item, and you never know what item what gate summons.
Oh, okay.
And then, a blob gate is summoned, and it has different themes, like a mystical forest, a desert, an ice palace, and you go inside of it for expedition.
That's pretty cool.
So yeah, and
you say they're blob, like they're the worlds of the blobs?
Yes, you can imagine it's like dungeons. They are procedurally generated, so every time you enter, the layout changes, and inside are white blobs, very special items, treasures, a lot of secrets. I won't tell everything now. And that's like where you can explore and test your trainer skills and see how far you come. I think no one will do it on the first try. You have like to train a bit. And at the end, a very strong boss awaits you, guarding eggs and treasure. So that's how it works. So it isn't like an open world. It's more like an area, and you can have portals to other worlds.
That's cool, though. I think that's a really that's sort of a great way to mix it up. So you have some explorable areas, and you also have like your main focus area. Like a lot of people who maybe haven't played farming games, you might know like Animal Crossing is sort of like that. But then you also have battling and other dimensions to explore.
Yes, so I hope that people will enjoy it, and I tried a lot with the procedural generation, that it still feels different every time you enter. So it and you don't find all secret on the first time you enter inside of it. So let's see.
Yeah, it's cool. It's cool.
And I have a Kickstarter reward, which is very special. So you can become yourself a blob adventurer or blob trainer inside this world. Mm. And the player can meet you and battle against you. So when he entered the... Yes. So if some of you want to become a blob trainer, go for it.
Oh, yeah. That's really cool. Yeah, it's always nice when devs have like sort of Kickstarter goals that sort of incorporate the community. It's always nice to see stuff like that.
Yeah, so I hope that some people will enjoy it. And I really am curious to see what blob trainers we will have in the end game when it's ready, what crazy people will we have around the town you can battle and meet.
I'm waiting. I have a feeling someone's going to want to be a trainer, but they're going to want to be based on the poo blob.
Oh my God. At the end, there will be like 200 poo blobs and one other blob. People will think, what is this game?
So Ova Magica has a crafting system. Can you explain how it works?
Yes, so you have a workbench around your farm area and in your house. And when you use it, it enters like the build mode. Hmm. And you see all the blueprints you have. So all the things you can build or craft. And some things are very functional, like a furnace with which you can smelt ores and create new things. Hmm. And some things are only for decoration, like a Christmas tree or jack-o'-lantern to decorate things and make it beautiful. And you don't have all the blueprints at the start of the game. You have to find it. So some you can get in the blob world, some you can get on the festivals in town. There are many places you can find them. And you see on the blueprint which materials you need to craft it. For example, like wood and stones and things like that. And to collect these materials, you have tools, an axe and pickaxe, a shovel, and you use it outside on your farm or in the blob worlds to chop down trees and, mine rocks and collect all the stuff you need. Some materials are more rare. You need to find them in special places or find treasures. And when you gathered all the materials, you can craft a thing and place it.
Oh, there you go. Yeah, no, it's definitely a lot of stuff to do.
Yes, this was a pretty long explanation, sorry.
No, that's great. No, that's great. People love to hear about what exactly is, what exactly goes into everything. So, no, it's definitely a great explanation. Sorry, continue?
Yes. So, Ed, are you the type of person who loves to decorate his house and farm in-game, or do you prefer battling more?
I'm personally more of a battling guy, but I do like a little touch of, like, customization and farming. So I'll probably spend a lot of time battling, but then I'll also do that on the side. That's sort of always been my kind of gameplay style anyway.
Ah, that's a good answer. I imagine if the famous gym leader, Ed, would tell, oh, I love to decorate and make everything pretty. When you play the game, when it's released, you can show me your house, how you decorated it. I'm curious to see it.
It's probably going to be completely like... uneven. I'm just like, oh, that looks cool. I'm just going to throw it in my house. That looks cool.
Oh, so you're more of a hoarder.
I'm a bit of a hoarder. You mentioned festivals. Can you tell us a little bit about festivals?
Oh, yes, of course. So one thing before the festivals is the game has three seasons.
Yeah.
Like spring and summer is combined one season. An autumn, fall season, and a winter season. And in the seasons, the environment changes, the blobs you can meet changes, and the town looks different. Hmm. And the festivals are like mainly seasonal. So you have, for example, in autumn, the Spooky Moon Festival, which is inspired by the real-life Halloween. Hmm. And the town is decorated very spooky. On each festival, the town is decorated in a different way, of course.
Yeah.
And there are like very special events and activities. For the Spooky Moon Festival, for example, the town is roamed by white blobs. Hmm. They attack the town, and you need to defeat like a very huge pumpkin blob boss. And the blobs drop candy. You can trade against cool prizes. So that's only one example. And the other festivals have like some very different activities. So it's like a very big game event. And it's a lot of variety, I think.
Yeah, yeah, very cool. I actually had a question. Will the festivals sort of cycle, or and will there also be like special event festivals? Like, for example, I don't know. Let's say there was something going on in the world, and you guys decided to do like would there be like special like events that take place?
So yes, there are special events in the world. You unlock them when you play, and the festival cycle because it's like a what you say, annual, yearly. So you have like in-game years which pass, and you have the new season come. So the festivals repeat, of course, the next year. So every year you celebrate like Christmas or things like that. But you have some special in-game events which occur only once.
Yeah.
So mainly they depend on the NPCs or romanceable characters you meet and the people you can battle with. So you can unlock like very special events.
Okay, cool. Will there be character customization?
So good that you ask. I really would love to have character customization. And it's a stretch goal on Kickstarter.
Okay.
Yes, I hope so much that we get so much support that we can reach it. For me, the most important thing is to add different skin tones and hair colors and maybe some hairstyles too.
Yeah.
So everyone can create a character he, she can at least a bit identify with.
Yeah.
So it won't be probably something like Sims that you can create like literally yourself. But I hope that you can create a person which looks a bit similar to you.
Okay, very cool. Next question is, will there be any sort of online functionality? If so, please explain.
No. I'm sorry, but yeah, it's a single player game.
Yeah.
And it's my first commercial game, my own game. So I wanted not to start with multiplayer because multiplayer is really hard to do.
Yeah.
And kudos to all devs who do multiplayer. So maybe Over Magica 2 will be multiplayer. But for the first one, it's single player. Yes, that's how it is.
Yeah, it's totally fine. A lot of developers, I've heard of this like in the indie scene, not just like not specifically Monster Taming, but a lot of developers will try to do too much for their first game. So they'll try to add this and this and this and this and this and that, and then they end up getting overwhelmed, and they're like, "Oh crap! I want to do this, but then it sort of like me personally. I know a little bit of coding, with Game Maker Studio, but
oh really? Well,
yeah,
cool.
I wouldn't know how to I've been able to sort of code like a simple battle system, but I couldn't code online. Like I have no idea how to do that. So I totally find that understandable. Like not every game needs to be online, especially if it's your first project and stuff like that. So totally understandable.
Oh, that's great. Oh, I am curious. What did you do with Game Maker? Did you a battle system or what was it?
Yeah, just I mean, in the past when I was like younger, I made like a little Metroidvania, but it doesn't have any VFX or any good sprite work because I'm very not artistic at all. So I just used a bunch of like squares and stuff to make the game basically. But it's a fully working game. It's a like a short, maybe like 4 hours to beat sort of Metroidvania style game. It has a few problems here and there, but it's functional.
Wow, that's not... Yeah. Is it online? Can I play it?
No, it's not. I took it down.
So all people who want to play it, write in the comments.
Maybe one day. Maybe one day I'll release it.
I bet you will cut out this part. I bet you will cut this out.
No, I'll keep it in. But yeah, other than that, like recently I was like messing around with like making a battling engine for monsters. And it's very simplistic. Like I haven't really fleshed it out, but... I've been working here and there, but like as someone who, you know, knows a little bit of coding, like I can't even fathom how much work goes into like some of these full games. It's insane. It's crazy. You guys do a ton of work. Like it's a lot.
Yeah, and that's the reason because okay, my English, sorry.
No, no, go ahead.
I started alone, but now actually more people work on the game.
Yeah.
So I do mainly the coding. So I'm a coder. I'm
Yeah.
pretty good at it. It's like my passion.
Yeah.
But we have now an artist, Ichigo. She draws the wonderful 2D portraits.
Yeah.
And we have Andy, he does the music. So what started as a hobby is actually now a professional project. Maybe
yeah.
I should notice or pointed this out earlier. So it isn't a hobby project anymore.
Yeah.
And we also partnered with Top Hat Studios,
yes.
Who enables us the console releases. So if you back the game on Kickstarter, you don't back a hobby project. It's
yeah.
Already a professional project with many team members. So don't be worried yet. That it's like a noob doing, oh, I want to have a dream. So this started like this, but now it's evolved.
Yeah.
But you
yeah.
can see in the Let's Play videos and also in the trailer how it looks. So I think it shows that it isn't... it's more professional now.
Oh yeah, for sure. I'll also leave a link to if anybody wants to see some gameplay. I played the BattleTech demo for about an hour. I got destroyed by the big but yeah don't think the game's gonna go easy on you. I know a lot of people like a challenge. That big blob kicked my butt pretty hard in the cave. So I'll leave a link to that too if you guys want to see some gameplay of the game. It was a lot of fun.
So if you want to see SS getting kicked,
that's it. Yeah. Someone in the comments is going to be like, what do you mean? Ed gets his ass kicked in every game.
yeah.
So you talked about the fusion system earlier. Can you explain exactly like what the stipulations are? Like how does a fusion system exactly work?
So it's a breeding system. So it's like you breed.
Crossbreeds, yeah.
Crossbreed, okay. My English, sorry. You breed like two blobs together.
Yeah.
And they make an egg, like a baby.
Yeah.
And so it isn't fusion because you get three blobs out of two and not one out of two. But that's like the base system. So you need two blobs and you care for them around one in-game week. And you have to feed them and treat them very well, patch them, so they create an egg, fall in love together. And depending on the things you feed them and how well you treat the parents, the child will be a different outcome. So it can be very strong. It can be like a very sad little blob you didn't feed the parents. And the child combines all the traits from the parents. And it's a bit of luck what you can get.
Yeah.
But you can also like manipulate. What's the word? You can like also do things. So you can decide, oh, I want to have a pink color. So I feed the parents like a special pink potion or something like that. And you will get a pink child.
Oh,
so it's
cool.
Not completely luck.
Yeah.
But when you do nothing, it's luck.
Oh, okay. I gotcha. Sort of like in Pokemon, when you breed two Pokemon, I mean, the Pokemon always look the same, but when you breed two Pokemon together, if you give it a certain item, it'll pass down its nature. If you give it a Destiny Knot, it'll pass down its IVs, stuff like that.
Yeah, exactly. And what's special in Over Magica is that the blob, the childs, don't look the same. So if you combine the poo blob with, let's say, the bee blob, you can get a poo blob with wings.
Nice,
and a
nice
new pattern. So yes, go wild and create poo blob army in different shapes and colors.
So this is more of a I guess a technical question, because this personally just fascinates me. Does it use like an algorithm to decide like which parts go together?
Yes, there is an algorithm, but actually it isn't so complicated like it appears in game. I think literally you have like different body parts of the blobs. So wings are a good example.
Yeah.
So there are like demon, angel wings, very different wings.
Yeah.
And of course, if you combine a bee blob with bee wings with a angel blob, you can get like bee and angel wings. So it's like one of those get chosen. But when you combine a blob with wings and one who has like an horn, both body parts can be passed to the child. So it's like a base system with body parts.
Oh, it's really cool. I always find like fusion mechanics so interesting because there's just so many possibilities.
Yes, and I'm really excited what the players will create, what blobs will come out. I think they will look crazy, but
it
I'm
must be
looking forward.
it must be really cool as a developer too, right? Because these blobs use like a specific algorithm. You wouldn't have seen every single combination, right? So that you're gonna sort of, as a developer, see new combinations that you might have not seen before too, right?
Yes, of course.
Yeah, it's
I'm
gonna
not
be
sitting
cool.
like 8 hours a day and finding all the combinations. So I think there can be some combinations which will look pretty interesting at the end. So I'm really excited to see them.
Definitely gonna have to get some poo blob fusions going on.
Oh my god. This poo blob will haunt me all day.
So so actually you did talk about this already, so I was just gonna ask, unless you have anything to add about customization regarding your blobs, but you mentioned how there's certain items you could use that sort of change their appearance. Will the game have any like held items or anything like that?
No, there won't be held items. The only possibility to customize your blobs will be with the breeding.
Yeah.
And that was my decision because I really want to encourage the player to breed and to like try many possibilities.
Yeah.
So that's like the main way in game to create your unique own blob. You have to breed it. It's like your baby and you have to raise it. Yes.
Does the game have like a IV system for its stats?
IV system.
What oh, yeah. A lot of people. A lot of people actually. So IVs in Pokemon are like it's like a hidden value where it's like this was born with these stats and they can't change and they range from. I guess since all the blobs are unique, it's sort of each one will have their own individual stats. But like for example, if I had two of the same blobs, could one of them have like bad stats and the other one have good stats?
Yes.
Or would they have the same stats?
No, they don't have the same stats. When you get a blob egg, it's always luck.
Okay.
How good the blob is. Mm. So, of course, they have like basic stats. So if you get a turtle blob, it's always more of a tank, not an very fast mover. But you can get like a super strong tank and like an Medicore.
Oh, okay. That's what I was wondering. Okay. Will there be a shiny equivalent?
Yes, there will be something like that.
Oh.
I don't want to spoil so much, but I can say, like, you have, like, the base blobs, for example, the bee blob, turtle blob, and every time you find a blob, there's a very small chance that you get a very special, stronger blob. So, like, the bee blob, but a bit more special and stronger and unique.
Oh, okay.
So, they are very rare, and it's by luck, but I still didn't decide how it will show in the appearance. Mm. If it will like be shiny, like in Pokemon, or maybe different color. So if the community has some ideas, you can feel free to write in Discord, or if you have some ideas, like shiny can work in Over Magicka, it's still only an idea. It isn't implemented yet.
Okay, cool. This will be answered for those of you guys on the Kickstarter, but I just wanted to have it said here. So what platforms are the games coming to?
So the game will be released for all major consoles, like Nintendo Switch. That's my personal favorite console for Over Magicka, but also Xbox. I'm very bad with the naming.
Oh, the newest one, right?
Yeah,
and I think it's called like probably Series X or something. I don't know.
yeah, like XS, I don't know. And the PlayStation 4 and 5.
Oh, okay.
And for PC, if you want to get a DirectM3, you can have the chance on Kickstarter. It will be released on Steam for sure. If you prefer an DRM version, you can access it on Kickstarter.
Okay.
And, what I want to say, we have like limited physical editions.
Yes.
And Switch.
Yeah.
They are very special. They are limited only for pre-order, and you have the chance to secure one on Kickstarter. So it's like the first Harvest edition. It has a special golden cover. You get like a certificate, Clovertown certificate, that you are like the first person who supported the game. Mm. So yeah, I'm pretty hyped about that. It's thanks to Top Hat Studios that we can offer this to the community.
That's awesome. Is there a certain number of people that can get the physical reward? Do you know the number offhand?
So for the pre-order, there isn't a number, but like super successful Kickstarter campaigns even didn't have 5,000 backers. Yeah. So like it's an intern number is around 5,000, but I don't think we will reach that. But we have also a collector's edition,
okay,
which is limited to 500 worldwide.
Okay. Okay.
And you have the chance to get this collector's edition on Kickstarter first, and this will be 500, and the other one is probably around 5,000. Mm. But I don't think that we will sell on Kickstarter all 5,000, I am honest. And you can, after Kickstarter, still pre-order it. But after the game is released, we will cap it. So if like only 2,000 people pre-order it, it will be 2,000.
Yeah.
It will depend on how many people will get it.
Makes sense. It makes sense. So definitely, if you guys want to get your hands on, I personally love physical game copies. So I try to do whatever I can to get a physical. I've always been like that. I love to have the game. So if anybody wants to get that physical copy, you gotta jump on that.
Yes, and it helps us a lot. If you get the physical copy, it of course is more expensive than the digital one, but it really supports the developers and us. And we have a lot of need for more art, more writing, more music. So I really hope Kickstarter will succeed.
I think we'll be good. I think you guys will do good. We'll do great.
Well, I trust you, Ed. It will be all your fault when we
talk. Oh, no. So next we have some community questions. And anyone watching, if you're not already in the Monster Taming Discord, what are you doing with your life? Come on, join the fun. You can ask questions like this. But so we're going to get through the community questions. And Ducky asks, what was the most what is the most stressful slash hardest part of developing a game, and what are some of the challenges you faced whilst developing Ova Magica?
Okay, so yes, that's a very good question. Actually, I would say the hardest thing is commitment. Is this the word? My English isn't so good.
Yeah, staying on track.
Yes. Mm. So when you do like a bigger project, you have to commit every day to it. You have to work or try at least to do every same day, like not the same thing, but work on the same project.
Yeah.
And it's not always like super fun. Maybe it's 90% fun.
Yeah.
But there are this 10% which are very repetitive, daunting, and you still have to do it. And for me, one of the hardest thing is actually, or was, like not to jump to a side project.
Yeah.
Many game devs do this, and it's very easy to say, oh, I have this super new idea for a game. I will just make it as a side project only. And then you kind of lose track and you work even more on your side project. And for me, at the beginning was the hardest thing to figure out how to stay committed. Mm. And but I managed to do it, and I actually don't have a side project, don't be afraid. yes, and the game came already very far, and I really want to pull this off. So it, I work every day, and all the other people who work on this very hard. So I have only one advice for you. If you want to be a game dev, don't start side projects. So even if it's very hard, just stick to your project and or decide maybe to drop it. But I wouldn't recommend you to do like many projects at the same time.
Yeah, it makes sense, especially with how much code goes into a game. Like I could see people easily getting mixed up.
Yes,
especially if the games are similar.
Yes, and it's always the most fun at the beginning.
Yeah.
Because like you add everyday new things. Everyday new things. But when a game reaches a certain point, and Ova Magica is already at that point, it's like I add new things, but it's mainly adding content. Mm. So you have a lot of content to play and polishing things. Mm. And this isn't like, oh, I'm a god, I'm making new things every day.
Yeah.
So yes, but I have fun. I love to do it. And I really can't wait for release day so you can play it.
Yeah, no, it's it's going to be great. So Crescent Sun asks, what are the complications and limitations of monsters all being the same body type or form?
I think one complication is that you have to be very creative so that they are all like have a base shape but still looks different. Mm. So that it's enough variety that it stays interesting but still looks like kind of similar. So I think we achieved that pretty well with many colors, textures, shapes, ears. And what is not a complication but maybe a bit of sad, like many people on Reddit sometimes not attic but complaints, oh, they only have the same shape. Hmm. So it's getting a bit personal to me. I know it's stupid, but it's also like the critique for it.
Yeah,
and that's, yeah, I have to live with it. It was a decision, but at some games, it can be hard. Yes, yeah,
everyone has their own personal preferences. Some people like it, some people won't. No matter what you do, you can't make everybody happy.
Oh, well, that's true, yes.
Retro asks, what was your original vision for Ova Magica, and how does it compare to what you have now?
Okay, so now every game dev will kill me when I say this, but I didn't have a vision at all. I just started throwing things in. I would love to play myself, and it was like an evolution. And what we have now is of course very polished already, but I'm very proud that it came to this point. And like it was a mix of many things, and with many work, it is now this game, which actually had already 3 tech demos released.
You could
play, and there wasn't like a prototype or a proof of concept. I know every game dev will kill me, but that's the truth. I just started, was creative. And in my opinion, many game devs will say start with a prototype. Maybe that's the best way. But I'd say just be creative and do what you want like to do. At the end, it will come out fine.
Yeah. Yeah, as long as you have passion behind it, everything will fall in place. Yeah. Marlon asks, and this is I always love it when these guys ask this question. Would you ever consider doing a crossover with another monster taming game?
Oh, I would love to do a crossover. Yes.
Go ahead.
So all the devs which do monster taming games, if you have a blob or a monster which would love to be a cute blob in Ova Magica, it will be cute, I tell you. You can write me.
Yeah, and I was about to say, like, I can imagine, like I don't know, I'm just making up an example here, but, like, let's just say, like, a dog, right? Like, it's a dog in one game, but it could be, like, a blob from the, like, it doesn't have to be a blob already, it can become a blob, right? That'd be pretty cool.
Yes, it doesn't have to be a slime or blob, but in Ova Magica, well, it will be a blob.
Yeah, exactly. No, that'd actually be pretty fun to see the, to see, like, a different version of the same monster.
Yes, so, but I have only one favor to ask. Kickstarter is really, really busy for devs, so maybe wait until Kickstarter is over.
Yeah.
So I'm but contact me, and I'm really hyped about it, and I think the challenge will be on the other side. So if someone
to turn a blob, they could always just keep it as a blob, because I'm sure they might not have a blob in their game, so now they have a blob, right? Poo blobs in every game.
Oh my god. who wants to have the poo blob come with me?
Speaking of poo blobs, Ducky asks, can I eat the blobs?
Can you eat the poo blob?
No, just he wants to know if he can eat blobs in the game.
Oh my god, what's with this question? Well, I didn't think about it, but when you ask, actually, there is a bit strange of a thing. When you battle white blobs, they sometimes drop meat.
Oh, there you go.
and you can cook it and eat it. So I don't know if this is actually blob meat. It's up to your imagination.
I think Ducky would only eat meat if it came from the poo blob, but you know.
Oh my god. And stop. Please stop now with this poo blob.
Marlon asks again, do you have any plans for Ova Magica after it's released?
I don't have many plans. My plan is to support the game. So that if people have issues and bugs or have maybe some wishes they really miss in the game, I will focus on that to support it. I don't have plans for any future game at the moment.
Okay. Neo asks, what is your main drive for making this game?
My main drive is actually to finish it. So to release it, yes, it's it's my first project, my own project, and I just want to achieve this. So I have for myself to show I can do it, and I know it will be released, but I can't wait for this day. Already am. So it will be released in 2022 if everything works by plan. I think so. We have a lot of spare room for new features and things, and I won't lie, my main drive is I want to be a game dev and make a living out of it. My main drive is also to sell it and so people can enjoy it, but also that I can make a living out of it and maybe do a game after this.
Doing what you love full time would be amazing. I wish I could quit my job and just do YouTube all day.
Yes, so actually when Kickstarter is successful, I will work full time on the game. And I actually am optimistic that it will work out, and I already worked almost full time on the game the last year. So it was first a side project after work, but I already cut down my main work, so I did it a bit more, and now I will do it full work until 2022.
Oh wow! Okay, that's great.
Okay, if Kickstarter fails, I will have to see what I do. But
yeah, for
let's
sure.
hope it doesn't fail.
We won't talk about that. I don't think that'll be an issue. what would you say the, and this is also asked by Neo, what would you say the primary aspect of the gameplay regarding, what is the primary aspect of the gameplay regarding the blobs, farming or battling or both?
It's definitely more battling and breeding. The farming is you produce food for your blobs and you feed them so they become stronger, and you do a lot of farming and your blobs can help you. They have abilities, a sprinkler ability. So the turtle blob can help you water your plants. And the blobs are mainly there for making them stronger, battling with them and breeding, creating your own blobs. So when you want to play the game mainly because of the cute blobs, you will have to battle and breed.
Okay. This next question, I choose the questions, but I didn't ask this. Umaru
asks, oh my god, what?
Umaru asks,
are you laughing?
What does
why
what
are
does
you
a
laughing?
Poo blob smell like?
Oh my god, no. What? Who asked this? I want to know.
Umaru.
Umaru, I...
Yeah, he wants to know what it smells like. I'm assuming it smells like cookies and rainbows.
Next.
Jex asks, how will the different romances affect gameplay?
Sorry, I can't go over this poop. Okay, it's like a really nice jump from Pooblob to romances. Really? What? Okay. So the romances are you have 13 different characters which have all their own blob. You can meet them, you can help them with their problems, and they can fall in love with you. And the romance aspect is rather the end play of the game. So at the beginning, you learn the people more, better, sorry, my English, and help them. And when you raise the friendship high enough and have done many events, you can go into romance option. And you can go into dates and do special things. And we have a marriage stretch goal on Kickstarter.
Okay.
It's the first stretch goal. So I really hope that we can at least reach that one.
Yeah.
And what's maybe cool for the monster taming fans is when we can do the marriage and you marry, you can breed your blobs together.
Oh, okay, so, cool.
So you can make like a baby blob.
You gotta date the person who has a poo blob.
There isn't a person with a poo blob yet, but well, we never know what can happen after Kickstarter.
That'll be the special edition gym leader Ed.
So now the special edition had like golden clovers, and the very special edition had golden poofs printed on it.
Marlon asks, would you want to do either a paid or a free expansion, either or, on the base game after it's released?
So like a DLC? Or
yeah,
or...
would you be interested in doing like a DLC, I guess, post-launch?
So currently there isn't planned any DLC which is paid. Hmm. I try to add all the vision I have into the base game. Hmm. And let's see what happens when the game is released. I will add for free new things which are very highly demanded. Mm. And when there is a very, very high interest and a lot of new ideas, we will see if we will do a DLC or maybe a new game. But actually, I try my best to add all the things already in the base game. Mm. I'm not such a big fan of DLCs, to be honest, because many games like hide content behind a paywall, and I don't want this for Over Magica.
Yeah.
The only thing what will happen maybe if like people have a lot of crazy new ideas which are totally new. Then maybe I will create a DLC if there's a lot of interest, but I will have to decide if it will be paid or free if the game gets enough support. It can be maybe even free. And maybe I don't want to do it in the same game. Maybe there will be a second part or a totally different game. But if you have ideas, please write me before release. I try my best to implement all in the basic game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. There's a lot. I think they call it like on-disc DLC or something, where sometimes you'll buy a game and the DLC is already in the code. Like the game comes out and the DLC is already on the disc. But they still make you pay for it later. Like, I like DLC when it's like, okay, the full game came out, and then after release they start working on something extra. But yeah, I know what you mean. Some companies they purposely leave features out, Game Freak, and then they make you pay for it later.
Yes, it is. Well, I think it's really crazy when DLCs get announced when the game isn't even released yet.
Yeah. and this is the last question for today. Cirque asks, what's your personal favorite blob or character, if they've been revealed yet?
So I think most people expect now that I say poo blob, but no, it's not a poo blob. So my personal fav blob is definitely the bee blob.
Okay.
It was one of the first blobs, and I like yellow and bees in real life. And for the NPCs, you can romance. It's Garnet.
Okay.
I like her because she's like very carefree. She enjoys life. She likes to party, good food. So I like like characters which are more of, not simple, but more of carefree. And
okay.
And Ed, your favorite blob is it really the poo blob?
Yeah, it's a poo blob.
Oh my god.
The poo blob's just too good.
Okay, so whenever I will add you in game, so you will have the poo blob.
Yes.
Is it really okay?
Yes
okay. Okay.
If there's a, you know, there's a giant mushroom, there could be a giant poo blob.
toilet
realm, like you go to like that special other dimension, it's just a big toilet.
Oh my god. Okay, there is a stretch goal where you can design a blob world. Oh my god,
someone's gonna have to make a mod.
Okay, so I will dream tonight of the poo blob. Okay, people, so but just to tell it, there are also other blobs. There's like a turtle blob, like a bunny, rabbit, yeah. cat blob. There isn't only poo blob in the game. Just let you know.
Okay, so we're gonna wrap things up here. I just wanted to say again, thank you so much to Claudia for coming on. I definitely look forward to continuing to cover the game as it sort of progresses through this campaign, and as it sort of gets ready for release and everything. I'm looking forward to keep, you know, covering the news and stuff. Again, thank you so much for coming on. Was there anything else you wanted to say before we sort of wrapped it up?
Yes, Ed, it was a pleasure. Thank you so much for having me.
Of course.
And thank you to all who endured my bad English.
Oh, no, honestly, you did great. You did great.
Yeah, you did it. You listened so long. And yes, so that was actually all. And I'm really happy that you gave me this opportunity to be on your podcast. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah, for sure. No, it definitely was. So for those of you watching, as of the time you're watching, which will be the 26th, I have a video planned for tomorrow, January 27th, that will break down all the Kickstarter information. For those of you who prefer to get your information in an audible format, like me, I hate reading, but I don't mind reading to you guys. So that said, again, make sure to check out Ova Magic on Kickstarter, Steam, and Twitter. And I'll leave the Top Hat Studios Discord server link in the description as well if you want to check them out. And yeah, we'll see you guys in the next one. Peace.